أما بعد فقال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم لا ينهاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم إن الله يحب المقسطين صلوات I'd like to begin by extending best wishes to all of you on this birth anniversary of the fourth Imam of the Shia faith, Ali ibn al-Husayn, Zain-ul-Abideen alayhi salatu wasalam. Our fourth Imam was known by different titles. Some of the titles are very similar to one another, but basically there are two kinds of titles that he has. One is Zain-ul-Abideen and as-Sajjad. These are the famous ones. Zain-ul-Abideen means the beauty of the worshippers, or sometimes it's translated as prince of the worshippers. And as-Sajjad means somebody who truly worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does prostration and sajda. These two titles together basically reflect his devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then there are two other titles by which he is known, and that is Al-Amin and Al-Adl. The trustworthy one and the just one. Not Adil, Al-Adl. Sometimes the person he represents the qualities that you don't say he possesses this quality, rather he actually totally is embodiment of that. So you don't say he is Adil, you say he is Adil. And so when you look at these two qualities, Al-Amin, trustworthy on one hand, and Al-Adil, just on other hand, basically these two things reflect his concern and his behavior with the people. And if we really want to understand the importance of our fourth Imam, I think these titles are sufficient. The first two ones are talking about devotion to God. The other two are talking about the concern for the people. Tell me, what else is left in Islam? Other than worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to have concern for the people, how you behave and interact with the people and the family, the community, and the society at large. One of the important things that we have from him as his legacy are his written works. Besides many, many sermons that he gave that his disciples wrote them down, you know, two items that he left behind which was written by him. One is the famous book of prayers known as as-Sahifa Sajjãdiyya, the Psalm of Psalms of Islam, as it has been translated in English also and many other languages. And the other is a smaller, you know, booklet, I would say, known as Risãlatul Huqūq, which consists of 50 rights that a human being faces in his life, you know, in different areas regarding us and God, ourselves and our faith, and the family members, you know, situations dealing with work and employment, how we deal with the people whom we employ or those whom we work for, the issue of business partnership, mutual rights that people have. Then we talk about the family members, members in the society at different levels. And so almost covering all aspects of human interaction with one another. In total, 50 short rites, mostly talking from the moral and ethical point of view. It's not a document of fiqh and legal perspective. It is more a document of morality and ethics. Tonight, what I would like to do is go to the last two items in Risalatul Huquq, where in right number 49, Allah, the Imam writes about the duty or the rights that we have to one another as Muslims. And then the last one is about how we behave and interact with those who are of other faiths. And this actually ties in with the theme I had last night about shiddat and rahmat. You know, it depends on the situation, how you react to people. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, if you look at the ayat of Quran from Surah Mumtahina, and I would like to base the statement of the Imam on this ayat, where he says, لا ينحاكم الله عن الذين لم يقاتلوكم في الدين ولم يخرجوكم من دياركم أن تبروهم وتقسطوا إليهم. The ayat is very clear. It says very clearly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not prevent you from being kind and from being just to those who do not fight against you for the sake of your religion, those who do not persecute you because of your religion, and those who do not throw you out of your homelands and your homes unjustly. Allah does not prevent you from exercising kindness and behaving in a just manner with them. Why? Inna Allaha yuhibbul muqsitin, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves those who behave in a just manner. Salawat pardon ikbara. And so justice is the minimum or the core value. All other things basically is built on it when we deal with the people, even those who are not from our faith. When it comes to the Muslims themselves, you know, item number 49 in Risãlatul Huqūq of Imam Zainul-Abideen, he talks about حق أهل ملتك عامة, the general rules that Muslims have upon one another. And it's interesting when he talks about it, about, you know, five items there. Number one, he says, إضمار السلام. إضمار is from Zamir. Zamir in Farsi, Urdu, basically refers to the inner state. Sometimes we use the translation of conscious. You know, in Urdu we say it's because Zamir mar chuka hai. You know, he's no conscious at all. And so here it's in the same, you know, sense that the word is being used, that the first thing as far as Muslim behavior is concerned is that your mental attitude is very important, your mindset. And what is that? That you should have this feeling of peacefulness towards others. You have to internalize this feeling, irrespective of their language, their color, their tribe, their social status. If they are people of your faith, then you should internalize this feeling. Amir al-Mu'mineen, in his document that he wrote for Malik Ashtar when he sent him as the governor of Egypt, and interestingly, Egypt was a province which had a sizable Christian minority under the Muslim rule. There he uses the same expression where he says to Malik Ashtar, you are a governor of the people of different faith, and therefore internalize the sense of mercy towards them. It shouldn't be, you know, a secondary issue. It should become part of your habit that when you deal with people, you know, mercy will always be automatically part of your behavior and your decisions. And then number two, the Imam says, وَنَشْرُ جِنَاهِ الرَّحْمَةِ. The first one was an internal issue. Your mindset towards the fellow Muslim should be such that you should have this feeling of salama, peacefulness towards them. The second is, lower the wings of rahmah, of mercy. This is an expression used in Arabic, that lower your shoulders. Now, it doesn't mean physically do like this. You know, what it means is that, you know, have this actively show. It is the issue of body language. The first was internal, you know, sense of having peaceful, you know, feelings towards others. The second is the body language, how you interact with them. You should, you know, express rahmah, you know, kindness towards one another. And this is very similar to, you know, the expression we had in the last night's discussion about rahmah baynahum, and that they were rahim towards one another. And so these are the foundation of that attitude. Internal feeling, and then externally, even in our talk and in our behavior and body language, we should reflect the sense of rahmah, compassion and mercy towards one another. But then, you know, a community has all kinds of people. Not everybody is perfect. Not everybody is ideal. You know, some people actually look for a community or a gathering of the people who are all good. Even some of our, you know, young ulama, mashallah, they're idealistic. They say, we want to be in the company of people who are righteous. And I say that, well, you know, Rasulullah didn't have that, those companions till the last day. Even after his death, he was not alone. You know, you have to realize dunya is dunya. A community is composed of all different kinds of people. There will be good and bad. You don't shun them. You know, you have to basically deal with all kinds of people. And this is where Imam says that, you know, if you see that there are some wrongdoers among them, وَالرِّفْقُ بِمُسِيِّهِمْ. When it comes to those who are not really, you know, good practicing Muslims, still have rifq. Rifq means, you know, this friendly and lenient attitude. Of course, you don't just let them do whatever they want or sanction what they want to do, which is haram. No, وَتَعَلُّفُهُمْ وَإِصْلَاحُهُمْ. And try to reform them. You know, correct their behavior, but in a loving manner, in a graceful manner. And this is where the issue of, you know, Islah and reform and change comes in. It is very important. It's an ongoing issue, whether we are talking about individuals or we are talking about communities. When we talk about reform and changing ourselves, this doesn't stop. We can't say individually or as a community that now we have reached to a point, there is no need for reform or change. No. And so that is a given. The whole challenge that we have is how do you do the reform? And this is where the Imam is saying, using the word rifq and ta'alluf, ulfat, rifaqat. You know, be friendly in your attitude towards them. This is how you'll be able to change their behavior and make them into good Muslims, inshallah. Salawat pranayik para. But don't even forget the good ones among them. You know, when it comes to them, washkur muhsinuhum ila nafsihi wa ilayka. And appreciate and thank the good ones in your community, those who are good to themselves or they are good to you. Think about it. Imam is saying those who are good to themselves, thank them also. Because if they are good to themselves, they will not bother you. So although they are good to themselves, Imam says still thank them, because when they are good to themselves, they will not bother you. And if they are good to you, then of course the demand for thanking them is even more. And then he explains that later on, why he said that even if they are good to themselves, still they deserve your gratitude and your thanks. فَعَمِّمُهُمْ جَمِيعًا بِدَعْوَتِكَ وَانْصُرُهُمْ جَمِيعًا بِنَصْرَتِكَ. And include all of them, the good ones as well as those who are not so good. Include all of them in your prayers, that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them better. And help all of them as much as you can in order to for them to become better. Salawat pranayik para Allah. The fifth point that Imam has, he says, how do you behave and interact with the people within the community? Now he's giving us a general guideline that you know how you interact with them. And this is for me and for each one of us. He says, فَأَنزِلُهُمْ جَمِيعًا مِنْكَ مَنَازِلُهُمْ. You know, accord them the respect according to their position. What does that position mean? He says, look at their age. كَبِيرُهُمْ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الْوَالِدِ. Look at those people in the community that you interact with them. If they are older than you, then place them in the place of your father and see how would you interact with them. How will you show respect to them? وَصَغِيرُهُمْ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الْوَلَدِ. If they are younger than you, then place them in the place of your child and deal with them out of, you know, compassion and concern for them. And if they are of the same age range as yourself, وَعَوْسُطُهُمْ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الْأَخِ, then consider them to be like your brother. So if you start looking people from that perspective, Imam is saying if they are older than you, then start looking at them as if you are, you know, interacting with your father. If they are younger than you, then, you know, deal with them as if you will deal with your own children. And if they are of the same age, Imam says, consider them to be your brother. And this is a golden, you know, rule or the guidance that Imam is giving to us, and which is general. And it actually covers all situations in our interaction with the people in the community. Salawat wa akbar. But you know, when we start doing good and following the path of Almighty God, there are challenges there. A day will come where I'll start feeling, oh, I'm very good. I've reached up there. That is shaitan. He doesn't go after the evil people. They're already on the, as I call them, autopilot system. He doesn't have to worry about them. He goes after the good people. And he says, okay, this person is behaving, you know, in a good manner with those who are older than him. He respects them like the father, for example, the younger ones as children, those who are of the same age as brother. And so this idea comes in that, you know, I'm very good. And that would be the beginning of the downfall on a spiritual level. There was a companion of the Imam, Zain-ul-Abideen, alayhi salatu wasalam. Who came to see him one day, and this is not in Risãlatul Huqūq, but connected to this right number 49 that Imam has there, and the guidance that he has given. He saw that Zuhri came in, and he was kind of distressed, you know, sad. And Imam said, what happened? He said, you know, I always try to be good to the people, try to be friends of people, but, you know, the friendship don't last. What do I do? And Imam uses the same formula. He says, you know, treat them, if they are older, like your father, if they are younger, like your child, if they are of the same age, like your brother. But then Imam said this. But remember, when you start doing it, shaitan comes in and puts this thought in your mind that you are better than them. And this is where Imam says, then you have to actually counter that, you know, misguidance from the shaitan. And now Imam says, look at them. Look at the people. If an individual is younger than you, then say to yourself, he's younger than me. Therefore, he had less opportunity to commit sins than me. Therefore, he is better than me. So your sense of arrogance will go down. If the person is older, Imam says in your mind, say to yourself, he is older than me, and therefore he had more opportunities to do good than me. So he is better than me. And if he's same age as yourself, then Imam says, you know about your own weaknesses more than what you know about him. So why do you allow yourself to be arrogant and say, I'm better than him? It's as if this is how you'll start thinking about issues, you will come to realize that you can maintain your relationship in the community in an everlasting friendship with everyone, inshallah. Salawat. This is as far as the issue of Imam is talking about how to behave and interact with the people within the community. Let me go to the last one. The last item in Risalatul Huquq, which is actually translated in English as the Charter of Rights, mostly on the moral and ethical basis. The last one actually talks about non-Muslims living in a Muslim society. You know, Imam lived at a time when Muslim empire had expanded. And now he's talking about what is the rights of the non-Muslims who live under the Islamic rule. And those are the people who are known as Ahlul Dhimma. He says, it is the right of non-Muslims living in a Muslim country that you should accept what Allah has accepted from them and fulfill the responsibilities which Allah has accorded them and refer to the laws of Allah about your responsibilities towards them. And if ever there is any matter of dispute between you and them, then decide according to the laws of God, even if it goes against your interest. Even though there might be a minority in a Muslim country, you still have to maintain the laws of justice and fairness according to Almighty God, and even if it goes against your own personal interest. And then the Imam writes there, he says, وَلَيَكُنْ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ ظُلْمِهِمْ مِنْ رِعَايَةِ ظِمَّةِ اللَّهِ وَالْوَفَى بِعَهْدِهِ وَعَهْدِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ هَائِلْ. Salawat. Imam says, when you deal with non-Muslims, especially in a majority Muslim country, if you have non-Muslim minority, Imam says there must be a barrier keeping you from doing any injustice to them, from depriving them of the protection that Allah has accorded them, or from flaunting the commitments of Allah and His Messenger concerning the minorities. This is a document written 1400 years ago, written by the great grandson of the Prophet of Islam, Imam Zainul-Abideen alayhi salatu wasalam. And we take pride in calling ourselves the Shia Muslims who follow this Imam. And this gathering this evening is to celebrate the birth anniversary of their Imam. And when we compare what he has left for us as the legacy of his teachings with what is going on in Iraq, for example, in ISIS or Syria, and the way Taliban, for example, deal with non-Muslim people in those areas, this is where we come to realize that ISIS and Taliban have nothing to do with the core values of Islam. If you really want to know what is Islam, you have to go to the Quran, to the Prophet of Islam and his family, the Ahlul Bayt, especially the examples and the documents that we have from the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. The fourth Imam, in this part where he's talking about non-Muslims, he ends by saying, فَإِنَّهُ بَلَغَنَا أَنَّهُ قَالَ. He says, be careful. Do not behave unjustly with the non-Muslim minorities. Why? Because we have been told within our family that our great-grandfather, referring to the Prophet of Islam, he said, مَنْ ظَلَمَ مُعَاحِدًا كُنْتُ خَصْمُهُ. That if somebody, you know, does injustice to a non-Muslim protected in an Islamic state, the Prophet says, I will be his enemy and opponent on the Day of Judgment. He is the Prophet of Islam and he is saying the Muslims, to the Muslims, that if you behave unjustly with non-Muslims in under your rule, then you will have to face me as your opponent on the day of judgment in the court of Almighty God. And this is where we see that, you know, we go through very difficult times these days, because we see these actions of some individuals in certain parts of the Muslim world, you know, which has nothing to do with the teachings of Islam, but the media has this stereotyping behavior of using that to tarnish the image of Islam and the Muslim world on a global level. And we hope that, you know, we should be able to fulfill our duty of, you know, sharing our values with the rest of the society here, so that the true image of Islam would come forth, and this is where people will come to appreciate the great legacy of Islam left by the Prophet and his descendants, the Imam of the Ahlul Bayt, especially Imam Zainul-Abideen, alayhi salatu wassalam. Salawat from the Akbar. Imam Zainul-Abideen was not only somebody who talked about these issues, moral and ethical behavior with people within and outside the community, in theory only, that he wrote about it or talked about it. Even when it came to his action himself, you know, his actions and his examples that we have in history, it's amazing. You know, we are very familiar with the incidents, the tragedy of Karbala, where almost his entire family was massacred by the army of Yazid, who was the ruler of that time. But one of the supporters of the government at that time, times changed in Medina, where Imam lived after the massacre of Karbala, with his family, peacefully, just, you know, teaching people about Islam. Things changed in the society. People of Medina rebelled against Yazid and his army. And one of the things they did was they actually threw out the governor of Yazid from Medina. And one of the elders of the Yazidi camp in Medina was Marwan bin Hakam. He was known to be an enemy of Imam Zainul Abidin and his family. But in difficult, you know, situation, when he saw this civil, you know, disobedience against the governor and his entourage, he felt threatened, more so about his family, that, you know, the mob mentality will take over, they might attack my home and, you know, harm my wife and children. So he goes around in Medina looking for refuge. He went to some of the individuals like Abdullah ibn Umar, a prominent member of the Sunni community at that time. Even Abdullah refused to give refuge to Marwan's wife and children. Finally, he comes to the door of Imam Zainul Abidin. You know, he was against the family of Imam Zainul Abidin. He was against his grandfather. He played a very active role in opposing his grandfather. He was also behind the scenes in the Yazidi campaign to massacre the family of Imam Zainul Abideen and his father in Karbala. In spite of all this animosity which was there and not hidden, on that day, Marwan brings his wife and children to the door of Imam Zainul Abideen. And he says, I don't ask for protection for myself. I request you to give protection to my wife and children in your house, because this mob mentality will not attack your home because you are from the family of the Prophet. And Imam Zainul Abideen did not hesitate even for a moment. You know, just think about it. Somebody who lost 18 members of his family in one day of the massacre of Karbala. And Marwan was part of that system who brought about that massacre. But this is the generosity of the Imam. This is this sense of mercy towards all. that even when an enemy comes and asking shelter for his wife and children, Imam Zainul-Abideen, this is his greatness, that he did not hesitate and open his doors and gave shelter and refuge to the wife and children of Marwan inside his home. And these are the examples that we have to keep in our mind and share with the rest of the society to understand the true image of Islam, the Prophet of Islam, and the family of the Prophet, the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Salawat. Imam Zainul-Abideen ki is wiladat ki munasibat se 2 saal pehle humne ek silsila yahan shuru kiya tha. Guftugu us par to humne pehle bhi ki thi ke zarurat is baat ki hai ki hum ahle bait ke silsile mein hamari jo mohabbat hai, jo jazbe wila hai, iska izhar angrezi shayari mein bhi ho. اور 2 سال پہلے ہم نے اسی مناسبت سے چوتھے امام کی ولادت کی مناسبت سے ایک پروگرام رکھا تھا الحمدللہ کمیونٹی نے اس کو اپریشیئر کیا لاسٹ ایئر کچھ وجوہات کی بنیاد پر نہیں کر سکے اس سال بھی ارادہ تھا کہ آج ہم وہی پروگرام کرتے لیکن چونکہ جسٹ اباؤٹ لیس دین 2 ویکس اگو ایک پوئٹری کا پروگرام ہوا تھا لہذا ہم نے سوچا کہ یہ بہت ہی اوورڈوز ہو جائے گا لوگوں کے لیے تو لہٰذا ہم نے چھوڑ دیا ہے انشاءاللہ میں بھی غدیر میں ہم لوگ اس کو ریپیٹ کریں گے اس طرح سے کہ جس میں اردو شاعری بھی ہو اور انگریزی پوئٹری بھی ہو ماشاءاللہ سے آج دو کلام ہم نے سنا جو تقریباً پارافریزڈ انگلیش پوئٹری ہے سپت جعفر شہید کی اور یہ امپورٹنٹ سٹیجز ہیں تاکہ نیکسٹ جنریشن کو ہم اس طرح سے تیار کریں کہ ہمارا دین و مذہب محفوظ رہے چاہے ہماری زبان بدل جائے آج کل بہت چرچہ ہو رہا ہے کہ ہمیں اپنی مدر ٹنگ کو محفوظ کرنا چاہیے and I'm not against it personally ہم بھی بلیو کرتے ہیں کہ کیوں نہیں اگر کینیڈا میں ملٹی کلچرلزم ہے 2 لینگویجز آفیشل لینگویجز ہیں تو کیوں ہم اپنی زبان کو بھی زندہ نہ رکھیں لیکن اگر سٹرگل ہے اس میں اور کامیابی نہیں ہو رہی ہے تو کم سے کم یہ بات ذہن میں رکھیں کہ ہم زبان کو بچائیں یا نہ بچائیں ہمیں مذہب اور دین کو بچانا ہے اپنی زبان میں نہ رہے تو انگریزی میں ہی صحیح تاکہ بعد والی نسل جو ہے اس دین اور مذہب کو اپنے اس نئی زبان میں سمجھ سکے اگر ہم مثال دیں نورتھ انڈیا کے جو سادات حضرات ہیں میجوریٹی میں نہیں ہیں شیعوں میں لیکن بہرحال ان کے انسیسٹرز شاہ تحماس کے زبانے میں ایران سے آئے تھے اور وہاں سیٹل ہوئے گورنمنٹ کے اس سسٹم کے لحاظ سے ان کے زبان فارسی تھی رہن سہن فارسی تھی یقیناً وہ مرچہ نہیں کھاتے ہوں گے سپائسی فوڈ نہیں ہوگا لیکن اتنے 400 سال گزرنے کے بعد کیا ہے وہ ہندوستانی سید سے کہے کہ سادہ کھانا کھائے وہ کہے کہ یہ دوا بیماروں کے غذا کیا دے رہے ہمیں ہاں سب کچھ بدل گیا زمان بدل گئی رہن سہن بدل گیا لباس بدل گیا طور طریقہ بدل گیا لیکن مذہب جاری رہا وہ جو وہاں ہوا تھا وہ یہاں ہونے والا ہے یہ ریالٹی اسے ایکسپٹ کرنا ہے ہم یعنی اس کے سامنے ہم بیریئر نہیں بن سکتے ہیں بلکہ ہمیں فیسیلیٹیٹ کرنا ہوگا اور وہی ہوتا ہے ہم چاہیں یا نہ چاہیں لیکن اگر ہم اپنے گھروں میں اپنے زبانوں کو محفوظ رکھ سکتے ہیں اس کی لطافت اپنے جگہ پہ ہے اس کی چاشنی اپنے جگہ پہ ہے ہماری مشرقی زبانوں کی شیرینی اپنے جگہ پہ ہے وہ ایکسٹرا ویلیو ہے اگر ہم بچا سکیں تو بہت اچھی بات ہے اگر نہ بچا سکیں تو یہ ذہن میں رکھیں کہ ہمیں دین و مذہب کو یقیناً بچانا ہے صلوات پڑھیں تو بہرحال آخر میں ہم فرزدق کا جو قصیدہ ہے عربی میں عربی تو ہم نہیں پڑھیں گے لیکن غالباً نسیم امروہی نے اس کو ہاں نسیم امروہی بھی تھے جنہوں نے اس کا نظم میں ترجمہ کیا ہے اردو میں یعنی عربک پوئٹری ٹو اردو poetry hai aur ye aasan nahi hota hai ki aap ek zuban se dusri zuban mein usko usi tarah se nazm ke unwan mein pesh kare. Ye wo waqia hai mashhoor, aap jante hain ke jab Hisham bin Hakam crown prince tha aur Makkah gaya, kisi ne tawaf ke liye koi jagah na di to baith gaya apne shami lashkariyon ke sath kone mein ki zara khalwat ho to hum jayenge tawaf karne. Lekin achanak logon ne dekha ki ek koi buzurg aaye aur haji hazrat unko dekh ke khud hi automatically jagah de di tawaf karne ke liye. To wo shami sipahi mein jo nahi jante the ye kaun hai, kisi ne pooch diya man haza, ye kaun hai. Hisham bin Abdullah Malik jo hai wo janta tha kaun hai, lekin baharhal wo hasad ka jazba tha, usne kaha ki hum nahi jante hain kaun. To wahan farzdak baitha tha aur ye shayar tha, batini taur pe shia tha lekin taqiyya mein tha, lekin us waqt usse raha nahi gaya, apne taqiyya ko bhul gaya wo. Aur extempore usne jo hai uske ye kehne par ki hum nahi jante hain ye kaun hai, قصیدہ اس وقت کہا ہے جس میں وہ آغاز کرتا ہے هذا الذي تعرف البطح وتعته والبيت يعرفه والحل والحرم. یہ وہ ہے جس کی طریقت سے ہے واقف بطحا, حرم و کعبہ ہیں عارف تو شناسا ہے دنیا. تھا جو سب خلق سے بہتر یہ پسر ہے اس کا, پاک بھی صاف بھی مشہور بھی اہل تقویٰ. یہ نشانی بے خدا احمد مختار کی ہے, صلوات اس پہ صدا خالق غفار کی ہے. یہ وہ ہے کہ جد جس کے رسول اکرم, راہ یاب اس کے ہیں انوار ہدایت سے امم. حمزہ و جعفر و تیار شہید و زیغم, ہیں اسی کے تو چچا اس کی محبت کی قسم. دل زہرا جگر ابن ابی طالب ہے, جس کی شمشیر دو دم موت پہ بھی غالب ہے. آخر میں ہم کچھ جملوں کو چھوڑ رہے ہیں پہ یہاں پہ, وَلَيْسَ قَوْلُكَ مَنْ هَذَا بِذَائِرِهِ. یہ سپاہی جس نے کہا تھا یہ کون ہے ہم نہیں جانتے ہیں, تو وہ اس کا جواب دیتا ہے, فرزدق کیا مضر ہے تیرا کہنا کہ یہ کون ہے بشر. تو نہ پہچانے مگر جانتی ہے دنیا بھر, بوسہ دینے کو وہ آیا ہے جو ہو جائے خبر, چوم لے نقش قدم پاؤں پہ اسود گر کے. یعنی یہ وہ ہے کہ اگر اسود کو معلوم ہو جائے کہ یہ کون ہے تو یہ نہیں جائے گا بوسے کے لیے, خود اسود جو ہے ان کے نقش قدم کا بوسہ لے گا. صلوات پڑھنا ایک بار. کچھ نہیں دور کے وہ اس کے جو پاس آئے گا, دیکھ کر دست مبارک پہ لپٹ جائے گا. کہ یہ حجر اسود جو ہے خود ہی ہاتھ کا بوسہ لے گا. کہتے ہیں سب قرشی دیکھ کے ان کو یہ بات, منتہائے کرم اور فضل انہی کی ہیں صفات. اور آخری شعر کہ امام کے جنروسٹی کے اور خیر و برکت کے بارے میں, کہ امام نے مروان جیسے شخص کو بھی لا نہیں کہا. مروان جیسا دشمن بھی آیا تو امام نے انکار نہیں کیا, اس کی مدد کی. اسی کانسیپٹ کو ذہن میں رکھتے ہوئے فرزدق نے ایک عجیب و غریب جملہ کہا ہے, اور واقعاً کچھ شعرا کسی کچھ مواقع پر جب بھی جملے بولتے ہیں, خود رسول اللہ نے بھی حسان بن ثابت کے لیے کہا تھا کہ حسان تم نہیں بول رہے ہو بلکہ جبرائیل تمہاری زبان پہ بول رہا ہے. یہ قصیدہ بھی تقریباً اسی زمرے میں آئے گا. ما قال لا قط الا في تشهده لولا التشهد كانت لاؤه نعم. یعنی آشنا لا سے ہوئی صرف تشہد میں زبان. تشہد میں کہنا پڑتا ہے اشہد ان لا الہ الا اللہ. آشنا لا سے ہوئی صرف تشہد میں زبان, یہ نہ ہوتا تو نہیں آپ کی ہو جاتی ہاں. کبھی بھی ان کی زبان سے پھر لا نہیں نکلتا. خداوند عالم کی بارگاہ سے دعا ہے خداوند اس قلیل بات قبول فرما, ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے, ہماری توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما. خداوند ہمیں ہمت اور معرفت اور وہ صلاحیت دے कि जो तालीमात हैं इमाम ज़ैनुल आबिदीन को कि उसको हम सही माने में उस पर अमल कर सकें। खुदावंद शियाने अली जहाँ जहाँ उनको हिफ्ज़ अमान में रख, दुश्मनाने अली सलफ़ी और तकफीरी अफराद की तमाम सलाहियतों को नीस्त तो नाबूद फरमा, इमाम के ज़ुहूर में ताजिल फरमा। रब्बना तकब्बल मिन्ना इन्नका अंतस समीउल अलीम।